Henry. Thank you for joining us for this edition of Health and Family. So today we're talking about a topic that some may say is a bit risque for a government television station. I am informing you, if you wish to have your children leave the room, this may be a good time. But I still would like for you to discuss this topic in your own words with your children, grandchildren, etc. This topic is that important and should not be ignored. We turn our attention to sexual abuse and its ramifications on the innocent child. Helping today to make sense of this topic are Executive Director of SCAS, Mrs. Debbie Ray Rivers, and the Chairman of the Board, Mr. John Brunson. We welcome both of you to Health and Family. Welcome.
Thank you.
So I wanted to start off with you, Mr. Brunson, as you are the Chairman of the Board. Give us some background information on yourself, and I guess Mr. Ray Rivers will chime in as to what actually started this organization.
Well, I mean, as you initially said, I'm the Chairman of the Board. But prior to that, in my past life, I was a former Member of Parliament,
yes.
Leader of the opposition, the United Bermuda Party.
I
have been an advocate for children and youth, whether it's the Deputy Chairman of the Learning Disability Association of Bermuda or the Duke of Edinburgh. So working with children, the concern for the well-being of children, and just helping children advance in a positive, holistic way has always been a priority for me, and especially as a father of two. You know, those things really come close to home, you know, to make sure that my kids have a great place to grow up, a safe place to grow up, and a healthy place to live.
Mrs. Ray Rivers, you actually started this organization?
I did.
Yes.
SCARS was born out of a tragedy 12 years ago. Both of my children were sexually abused by a trusted family member. As our family went through this very painful journey, we started to share our story with family and friends, and we realized that it had affected a lot of other people. But there was just so much shame attached to it, and it was very taboo 6 years ago. So October 27th, 2011, SCARS was born. And it was born out of, like I said, out of a tragedy. And so I knew that in my heart that we needed some more education around this issue. And that's when I flew to Atlanta and became a trained facilitator in 2010 in our what we're using now here in Bermuda to educate our people is the Darkness to Light Stewards of Children training. And I brought that back to Bermuda, and then SCARS started October 27th, 2011.
All right. And for the record, SCARS is an acronym?
It is.
All right, so you want to tell us what it stands
SCARS
for?
Yep, so SCARS stands for Saving Children and Revealing Secrets.
Saving
Children and Revealing Secrets. Sexual abuse is a secret. Our mission is to reduce the risk of child sexual abuse in Bermuda and to be an advocate and a voice for children who've been sexually molested as well as their affected families.
All right, so I didn't want us to be graphic with the next question, but if you could just sort of in a nutshell tell us what child sexual abuse is, what it consists of.
Well, child sexual abuse really involves any inappropriate touching, any inappropriate sexual conduct between an adult and a child or between two children. And it is really the most, as Darkness to Light says, the most prevalent health problem that children face with a very serious array of consequences.
All right, so Mr. Brunson, in your estimation, why don't children readily, you know, I'm a school teacher and I know I'm on the playground, they'll readily come up to you, so-and-so hit me, so-and-so did this, but yet they won't reveal when someone touches them inappropriately.
I mean, one of the main reasons why children don't want to disclose that they've been sexually abused is fear. Fear that they will not be believed. I mean, in our community, many times we say children are meant to be seen and not heard. And when they do share something as traumatic as sexual abuse, most times the reaction is disbelief. And when you understand the nature of the abuser, you have to think about who they are and what motivates them to do and create such a heinous crime. And you know, the idea of stranger danger is less of a risk to our children. The typical perpetrator is someone that is known to the victim, someone we know, love, and trust. And so when you layer that onto the burden of a child to disclose, it makes it very difficult for them to want to share for fear of belief. I mean, in addition to that, you know, they sometimes think of what the consequences might be. You know, what will happen to mommy or daddy? Because we as adults, when our children are harmed, our natural reaction is to say, if anybody hurts you, I will, you know, and you have a consequence that could be grave. And that's scary too. And the other thing about the crime of child sexual abuse is because the perpetrator can be known to the victim,
right.
There may be a love and affection because it can be a family member.
Yeah.
And so, you know, you layer all those things on, and you have to think about this. We're talking about a child, and they don't necessarily have the mental maturity to understand. And so all they think is protect or fear of disclosing or not being believed. And that's a hard thing to do. And we always say that, you know, when a child has the courage, and it takes a lot of courage given those variables for a child to reveal, we have to believe them as caregivers and parents.
Yeah, it's interesting that you talked about, usually it may be a relative of someone, because that was sort of my next question. Who actually does the abusing? It could be a trusted member, Ms. Rivers?
Yeah, 90% of people who abuse children are people we know, love, or trust. Only 10% are strangers. And when it comes to sexual abuse, the reason I think that is because it does take a grooming process. They want to make sure that whoever they're going to do this to is not going to tell, because it is the shame of the perpetrator. Sex offenders don't sexually abuse children in public,
right.
So there's a bit of shame on their part. And they want to make sure that they're not going to get caught and that this child isn't going to tell. So they want to choose the child that they think may not say anything. And so that takes a grooming process. And so that most children don't, you know, nothing silences us more than shame. And so they need to make sure that the child they choose is the most vulnerable child that they don't think will speak up and say something.
So I kind of think you're talking about the characteristics of a child molester.
Yes, absolutely.
Could you delve into that a little bit more?
Yeah, absolutely. So if we're talking about an adult sex offender, because we can't forget that 40% of people who abuse children are also older, more powerful children. Mm-hmm. There are child-on-child abuse.
Because they usually were sexually
abused themselves. And so the characteristics of a child molester, I would say somebody who really pushes for one-on-one time with children, somebody who's very bully, has bullyish behavior, manipulative, and somebody who is always trying to also win over the people because they don't want to get caught. So they can be the best coach, the most favorite teacher. The most favorite relative in that family. And so they want to be the best at what they do so that they don't get caught. But they're also, very bullyish behavior. I'm going to do this. You know, they'll push to get into the bathroom with the child in a bathroom alone. Or they don't understand boundaries. So they might tickle a child. And the child's saying, stop. And, you know, that's where they can they keep going, you know, saying, I don't care what you want. I'm going to do this anyway.
And that's actually one of the things I really want to work in the coming year is the personal boundary, because that's so important. I don't think a lot of children realize, hey, you're a little too close for me and so forth. So can you talk a little bit about that as far as the boundary and the good touch, bad touch, which I know the counselors in our school,
they do
cover that. But if you could just expand on that a little bit more.
I just wanted to add on to Debbie's last point, and that was, do not assume that someone's social standing in the community is going to make your child safe.
Mm-hmm.
And we also say that it's a parent's responsibility, it's an adult's responsibility to protect children. Mm-hmm. Children are not mini adults. And I don't think anyone in the listening audience or in Bermuda would disagree with that. And so it's very, very important to understand that someone's social standing in the community will not make your child safe. And we as parents have a responsibility to protect our children and do our due diligence in knowing who we entrust our children with.
Yeah. If it even means just doing a little bit of research on that individual, on that coach, on that teacher, on that trusted, even somebody just teaching piano or something of that nature,
exactly.
After school activity. Yeah. So what is a good age to begin the good touch, bad touch discussion?
Yes. Darkness to Light, the training that we use here in Bermuda to educate our adults, says 8. 8 is great. That's kind of what they teach in the training to say. But we've had people say 8 is too late. We need to start having these conversations very early. And, you know, there's a conversation that you could have with a 3-year-old is nobody touches you in your bathing suit area.
Mm-hmm.
And you shouldn't touch others.
Okay.
It's also respecting other children's bodies.
Right.
And to let children know that they have a voice, that their body belongs to them. And I think we as adults can model that by not forcing affection. Children should not have to give a hug and a kiss to a family member or to that favorite, you know, person in their life if they don't want to. That they have choices and that they have boundaries and that they should respect other people's boundaries. Also, the mouth is another area. Nobody should touch you and, you know, be touching you in your mouth. Mm. Your mouth is a private area. So it can be a very easy conversation, age-appropriate conversation to say, nobody touches you in your private areas. These areas are very private and special, and they belong to you. And if anyone ever does touch you in those areas, you can come and tell me about anyone and about anything. And I think that's what gives children that opening to say, oh yeah, that person did that and I didn't like the way it felt and I'm gonna say something and I'm gonna be valued. It's okay that I say this. And I think we hear a lot of stories about child on child, and I think we have to really reinforce to our children, they should not be touching others either. And to really respect other children's boundaries, because yes. not everybody likes to be hugged and kissed. Not yes. everybody wants, yes. I'm a hugger and a kisser, but I've learned to ask permission.
Yeah, that's true.
And not everybody wants to be touched, especially if they're being abused at home. The last thing they want to do is be touched. And we're trying to even get professionals to understand that as well. Mm-hmm. You know, if you're a swim coach or a gymnastics coach or a dance teacher or a soccer, before you ask someone to show them something, a mechanical move, ask permission. Mm-hmm. Do you mind if I just show you how to do this, or would you rather me explain it and you watch what I do? Mm-hmm. You know, we need to let children know that they have choices.
Yes.
Even though they're little?
Yes, and I think that the mere fact that you're talking about start early rather than later, so that they have this trust with you, with the parent, to say, listen, Uncle so-and-so touched me, or Coach so-and-so,
yes.
so that the belief is there, because I think a lot, as you alluded to, some children feel they're not going to be believed.
Absolutely.
At all, and so forth.
And can you imagine if you're a parent who gives punitive punishment.
Mm-hmm.
If you're the type of parent that gets mad at your child for bringing a bad grade score, you're yelling at your child because they dropped something walking home from school, or that child will never come and tell you about
yeah.
sexual abuse, because you get mad at something like that, you'll be so angry if they tell you that your boyfriend has been inappropriately touching them. They're thinking about the response of the mother or the family member.
What I would also say good touch and bad touch is a very good dialogue to start the conversation with our children.
Right.
And again, we say start early and talk often.
I agree. Yes.
But I have to be very clear that child sexual abuse is not just a matter of touch.
Mm-hmm.
It is voyeurism, which means someone can expose their body to a child.
In today's world, yes.
Or have someone look at them mm-hmm. and look at their body. Mm-hmm. No touch involved. It can mm-hmm. be exhibitionism. You know, where they expose themselves or ask the child to expose the child to expose
yeah.
themselves. You know, it can be showing pornographic information,
mm-hmm.
videos
mm-hmm.
to children.
Mm-hmm.
Right, all of those start the process of grooming a child. And we've had victims who say, you know, their perpetrator would say this type of behavior
mm-hmm.
is a rite of passage. All children go through this before they have a boyfriend or a girlfriend. And at the age of 5 and 6, they don't know any different. You know, so they assume that that's what's right and appropriate.
Okay, well, hold on to that thought. We're headed towards a break, but we wanted you to take a look at what some community members are saying about this matter.
As a coach, it's my responsibility to protect children.
As an educator, it's my responsibility to protect children.
As a member of the clergy, it is my responsibility to protect children.
As a parent, it is my responsibility to protect children.
And as a child, it's my right to be protected.
And we thank you for rejoining us. We're in the midst of discussing the topic of SCARS and the lasting impact it may have on the innocent child. Mrs. Ray Rivers and Mr. Brunson are our guests. Mr. Brunson, you were making a point before the break.
Yes, I was just speaking about good touch, bad touch,
mm-hmm.
and that the scope of child sexual abuse goes beyond that. And I just, you know, wanted to just let people know that there are many things that can constitute child sexual abuse. And as I said, allowing children to view inappropriate pornographic material, whether it's media or written.
Mm-hmm.
The conversations that people can have that are inappropriate, it's voyeurism and exhibitionism. And so what we really try to get out as a message is that for a child, anything that makes them feel uncomfortable,
mm-hmm.
they should tell their parents or a trusted adult.
Right, right, yeah.
And then the parents should own the problem and find a way to deal with it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the one takeaway is, for a child, anything that makes them feel uncomfortable, whether it's touch or not,
mm-hmm.
They should tell and communicate that to a trusted adult.
Okay. So I wanted us to go to another sort of population of our children, which are those that are children with a disability, because they may not be as vocal. And I wanted you to sort of answer the question as to how we can reduce the vulnerability of those children in those positions. Mrs. Ray Rivers?
So there's a few things we can do. We can talk to our vulnerable children about what's okay and what's not okay. I think many can understand that. We can also teach them how to say no. That's a powerful word when somebody's doing something that they're uncomfortable with, and teaching them about those body safety and boundaries. But I think really for a parent of a vulnerable child, I think it's to look for behaviors in that child.
Yeah.
Do we see a change of behavior?
Be
observant.
Yeah.
I think we need to hold accountable the people that take care of those children. Ask them, have they done any sexual abuse prevention training?
Mm-hmm.
Ask them if they have a code of conduct for the adults and volunteers and staff that work in that organization, and ask to see a copy of it. And in your language with your child, speak to your child about what's expected. So that child knows when something is being done that's not right, they at least maybe can tell you. So really sharing that document with the child in your words. But I think mostly we're looking for a change of behavior.
Right.
Are they suddenly aggressive? Do they suddenly not want to go home with this person?
Yeah.
They suddenly not want to go to school and you've ruled out all other possibilities or go with a certain adult somewhere.
Yeah.
Really start listening and finding out and asking some specific questions.
But I would also say when we talk about vulnerable people, they are probably the most high-risk category, because some of them do have the inability to process information and comprehend information, and they may have disabilities which prevent them from understanding what is safe and what is unsafe. And this is why we said at the outset that it's an adult's responsibility to protect children.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you have vulnerable people in your care, it's key that the organization does have a code of conduct which establishes a benchmark of how they interact with the children. But with vulnerable people, you need to have an extra layer, and that is when people are interacting with them, especially in a one-on-one scenario, they should be openly observable, which means you either have a facility that has an open floor plan, you have cameras, or some sort of accountability tool that minimizes the opportunity of someone having a one-on-one, which is the greatest risk. Isolated one-on-one situations create the greatest risk to our children. You want to minimize those and ensure that in an environment you definitely have the tools to enable that to happen. Because you have kids who may be deaf, kids who may have processing issues, kids who may, and so we have to care for them, and we have to care for them with a greater degree.
People prey on them a little bit more, I would think,
because they can't speak for themselves.
Exactly.
And as Debbie said, you know, our objective is really to give a voice to the voiceless, and that goes to, it's a granular statement, you know, and the vulnerable people in particular.
Okay. So now a child has been abused, sexually abused. Without a doubt, there's going to be some type of ramification for this child if it's not dealt with psychotherapy or psychoanalysis. How can you respond to as far as really emphasizing that the child gets some type of help for this situation?
Yeah, well, that's crucial.
Yeah.
And healing comes in many forms.
Right.
And so I think intervention is key for a child, because they have to get that pain out. They have to get their power back. They have to get their they have to deal with their trust issues. There is a spillover to sexual abuse, whether that's going to be promiscuous behavior, not trusting other people, maybe using a drug or some other addiction to numb their pain, because that's the only thing they have control over. Whether it's an eating disorder, or whether it's alcoholism, or whether it's drug addiction, that is where they go to numb out, or that's where they go because that's the only power they have, because their power was taken from them when they were little. And so there is a spillover, and healing is critical. And they should go to a professional who understands this issue, that can do the right type of therapy and help them. But there's other forms of therapy that we can continue with, which is like art therapy, or, you know, some sort of, you know, jiu-jitsu class that you can get your power back.
Right.
And kinesiology, which helps the body. So there are a lot of forms of healing, and that is critical in once it has been discovered that a child has been abused. It is so crucial to get the healing that they deserve.
Okay. I wanted us to talk about, we don't have much time, but I wanted us to give some attention to a sexual offender registry. Do we have one here in Bermuda?
Bermuda does have a sex offenders list.
Okay.
It's not a public sex offenders list, but it does exist.
Why is it not public?
Well, it isn't public because it hasn't been mandated to be public.
Okay.
And that's something that can be changed through legislation.
Okay.
But this is another message that I really want to be very clear to the community, and that is the public sex offenders list is one tool that helps us to minimize the risk to our children.
I know it's not the end all, but it
but
is.
But given that 90% of the time the typical perpetrator is known to our victim, the greatest threats are not people that will appear on the public sex offenders list. It's those that do not.
Uncle so-and-so, auntie so-and-so.
And do not assume that someone's social standing in the community will make your child safe.
And you mentioned that before. So there's a point behind that because you mentioned it before. So I'm assuming that's a very, very important point, because I think a lot of people would use their status in the community to sort of mask that they are sexual.
I mean, we can't afford not to have a list with the way, with our present laws.
Yes. Okay.
Because sex offenders go to prison and they have a choice when it comes to parole whether they are going to choose to be healed and to help in that. So if they get out without any healing, they're a risk to not only children, they're a risk to themselves, because this isn't just a one-off thing. They don't just wake up one morning and decide that they're going to be sexually interested in a child.
Right.
That is, you know, starts with thoughts, and they need tools to help them. So right now there is no protection for children without a list, because they are not managed in the community. They are not mandated to have healing. So they come out as sick as they were when they went in.
I wanted to talk about, do you advise that the offender the victim rather, sort of have a confrontation as this is a part of healing? Would you say yes to that or no to that?
I think that depends on the victim.
Okay.
I think a victim has to be ready in their journey to do that, and that is only a victim's choice.
Okay.
My daughter chose to confront her perpetrator, the person who abused her.
Okay.
And forgiveness doesn't mean forgetting. It's just for you yourself to let go of that.
Okay.
That doesn't mean we have to have relationships with people that harm us. But that really is a victim's choice.
I'm almost about to go off, but I wanted you to talk about the workshops that you offer, of which I attended a few years ago, and one of our field techs has also attended. If someone would like to have a workshop with you guys, what is the process for that?
Well, they would email us at training@scars.bm or call us at 297-2277.
Okay.
We work 7 days, seven nights. We have over 40 facilitators in our community, volunteer facilitators facilitating this training.
Mm-hmm.
Also, they can sign up for our monthly community training. It happens every month on a Saturday at Argus from 9 a.m. to 12 noon.
Mm-hmm.
All the dates are on our website. Mm-hmm. Argus very generously donates their beautiful boardroom to us.
Awesome.
Buzz, Take 5 Limited, cater it, and we're grateful for both of those organizations that help us, and we've been doing it for 5 years. Every month at Argus you will see a training. John facilitates that training once a month.
Fantastic.
And there's no cost for our training.
Fantastic.
We continue to raise money so that no one has to pay for this. So we have wonderful corporate and community donors that we're grateful for, so allow us to continue doing our work for no cost.
So unfortunately our time's up, but any final words? Very minimum. Go ahead.
What I'd like to say to all the victims out there, that you did nothing wrong, and if you choose to disclose, I hope that the people you choose to disclose to will believe you. And I just want to stress that you did nothing wrong and you didn't deserve what happened to you. And healing is possible, but you have to have the right support. And you can contact SCARS to help us. We can help you and move you in the right direction to get that type of support.
All right. Thank you so much. The hard facts about this topic is that 1 in 4 girls will be sexually abused before their 18th birthday. 1 in 6 boys will be sexually abused before their 18th birthday. 9 years old is the median age where children are sexually abused. These are some of the statistics that were provided by SCARS. We ask that if you need assistance in talking with your child about this subject, to please contact the good folks at SCARS. They would be more than happy to discuss this matter with you. At the end of the day, an innocent child should not be made to suffer because they were too afraid to talk with you. Communication is the key here. Observation is the key here. Let's do right by our children. I'm Shay Dawn Burgess, and this has been Health and Family. Thanks for joining us.
As a coach, it's my responsibility to protect children.
As an educator, it's my responsibility to protect children.
As a member of the clergy, it is my responsibility to protect children.
As a parent, it is my responsibility to protect children.
And as a child, it's my right to be protected.